Okay, so let's finish the class with the Poisson dispersion test. That'll be the last topic. And I began it last time. And you might have some glass plate that you're looking at under a microscope, or this another example in the text is that there's a filter and catches asbestos fibers, and you're counting asbestos fibers. And you might break this up into either a grid like this. And you count the number of particles in the ith cell. So you count how many of the particles you're interested in here. It might be bacteria, it might be asbestos fibers. So x1 would be how many things you see in here, x2 how many in there. Or you could sample in a different way. They mention in the book that you take circular punches out of the object in a random way. And you count how many things you see in each of these circular punches. At any rate, you get counts x1 through xn. There are n cells. And then you want to test whether the distribution of the particles is Poisson with a constant parameter in every cell, or in other words, it's sort of it's a uniform distribution of particles throughout the whole square or whatever region you're looking at, or whether the Poisson parameter varies from cell to cell. So you want to test. So you assume, I guess. You want to test H0. So you form this generalized likelihood ratio. Okay, so what could the range of lambda be? It's a parameter for Poisson, so it has to be a non-negative number. So lambda in omega naught means omega naught should be what? Yes. Non-negative real numbers. Maybe I should exclude zero because I don't know what Poisson with parameter zero would be. I guess that would mean nothing happens. There's nothing to be seen. And so the dimension of omega naught is 1. And what would the dimension of capital omega be? Well, what is capital omega? It's a parameter range for lambda 1 through lambda n. This would be the Poisson parameter in cell 1, cell 2, et cetera, up to cell n. Are you familiar with this product notation for sets? You know probably R2, you know. It's a cross product, right? You know things like this, right? R2 means R across itself. This would mean 0 infinity cross itself n times. So the dimension of omega is n. And now let's see what the, well, numerator is. That's just what? Assuming the counts in different cells are independent, Poisson random variables, you're probably seeing Xi particles in the ith cell, if the distribution is Poisson with parameter lambda, would be lambda to the Xi over Xi factorial e to the minus lambda. And last time, towards the end of the hour, I was probably going too fast or wasn't thinking, and I put lambda xi here. Go back and look in your notes. There's no xi there. It's e to the minus lambda. So this is the probability of seeing x1 particles in cell 1, x2 particles in cell 2, up to xn particles in cell n. And if we maximize this over lambda, what's the maximum? Remember the maximum likelihood estimator? Lambda hat is equal to X bar. Okay. And then the denominator. So to conclude, then the maximum over lambda in omega naught of likelihood of lambda is what we get when we put x bar in here for lambda. So it would be product I equal 1 to n lambda hat to the xi over xi factorial e to the minus lambda hat. And now we look at the likelihood function in the denominator. This product, again, assuming that the counts in different cells are independent, probably seeing xi in cell I would be this, because it's a realization of a Poisson random variable with parameter lambda I. And we want to maximize this in lambda I. But now what do we have? We have a product of n functions in looks like this. It's F1 of lambda 1, F2 of lambda 2, etc., Fn of lambda n. And there's no lambda 2 or any other lambda in here. There's no other lambda in here. There's no other lambda in there. Just, okay? We want to maximize this. So how can you maximize that? Well, you maximize this one over lambda 1, that one over lambda 2, that one over lambda n. You do each one individually, right? So what would be the maximum of what? The ith one. Xi is fixed. We want to maximize this in lambda I. How do you do that? Well, let's take the log. Remember, if you find where the log of a function takes on its maximum, you've also found where the function takes on its maximum because the log is increasing. So let's take the log of this and then differentiate with respect to lambda I, and we'll get a result that's not very surprising. Any guesses? Xi, yeah, just Xi. Now you might say that I've forgotten something when I went from here to there. There is something that's apparently missing, but in fact it's not missing.
That's why we didn't say anything about it.
Okay, right. Good, so let's not even mention it.
What was it?
Is the log of the xi factorial. And why didn't I bother writing it over there? Because, yeah, I'm differentiating with respect to lambda I. Back it up. Okay. Thanks for allowing me to say it. I didn't pay him to do that. Okay, this is zero when xi is lambda I, right? How can something minus one be 0, this something has to be 1. How could that be 1? The numerator must be the denominator. So I'll call that lambda I bar. Okay, that's the MLE in this case. So back over here then. So lambda would be the ratio of these two maxima, that one and this one. And now both of them have a 1 over xi factorial product I equal 1 to n. So the xi factorials cancel. And you'll get a product I equal 1 to n, lambda hat, that's raised to the xi. Lambda bar will be in the denominator. That's also raised to the xi. Lambda bar I raised to the xi. And then you get an exponential term. Here you get a, this is in the denominator. When it comes to the numerator, it gets a plus sign. Okay. Now let's write this more explicitly in terms of the observations, the little xi's. It becomes that. And now, remember, when the number of observations is large, minus 2 log lambda is chi squared. with degrees of freedom, dimension of capital omega minus dimension of omega naught, which would be chi squared with n minus 1 degrees of freedom. Okay. And we base test statistics on this sample distribution then. So let's write down what minus 2 log lambda is in terms of the data. It's given by taking minus 2 log of this. I'm going to reverse this fraction here and get rid of this 2. I mean, minus sign. Period. Because this means that there's nothing else. I'm not going to write anything else. Why is that? Yeah, this is 0. Okay. Okay, and like as in the Pearson statistic, we can also expand this thing again. Taylor expansion of a function says if you want to expand to second order, the function at point x, if x is close to x bar, f of x is approximately f of x bar plus f prime of x bar, x minus x bar plus f double prime, etc. And so we should figure out what this is, that's f at x bar. What's the value of this thing when I put x equal to x bar? Put x bar in here, this becomes 1. Log of 1 is 0. So this would be 0. Now, the second one, what's going to happen to it? I'm going to evaluate f at xi. That's what's in here, right? And what do? We add that up from 1 to n, okay? So I'm going to put in here f prime of x bar xi minus x bar, and I'm going to sum that from 1 to n. Does this depend on xi, this part? No. So in a sum, you can factor that out. So you're summing this, where there's an xi here, I equal 1 to n. What happens with the sum of that? Sum xi minus x bar from 1 to n. Well, that we just saw, that's 0. So this part goes away. So the only thing that will make a contribution here will be the second derivative. So we'll have an xi minus x bar squared over 2. And then the second derivative of f with respect to x. So let's see what that is. Here's the scratch paper. F of x is x log x minus x log x bar. F prime of x is log x plus what? I differentiated this, multiplied by that. Now I have to take this and multiply the derivative by the derivative of log. Derivative of log is
1 over x.
Right, 1 over x times x is. And here I differentiate that, log x bar. And then we get, so here, if you were curious about what f prime of x bar is, what is it? It's log x bar plus 1 minus log x bar is 1. Second derivative is just 1 over x. So f double prime at x bar is 1 over x bar. So this thing is also approximately equal to, when we add up this thing here, this is 0. This one adds up to 0. And this one gives us a sum. Here's a 2. There's a half. They cancel. We get a sum. I equal 1 to n xi minus x bar squared over x bar. And this is, we'll call that capital X squared. So capital X squared and minus 2 log lambda are almost the same. And and chi squared with n minus 1 degrees of freedom. So this last one is, this is the sample variance. It's given by this. So this capital X squared is n times the sample variance divided by the sample mean. And this is some sigma hat squared over x bar is called the dispersion. And so a test based on this statistic is called the Poisson dispersion test. So what would the test look like? I erased what we're testing. We're testing whether lambda is constant in this throughout the cells. Versus lambda I varies from cell to cell. Okay. Now, what would it look like if lambda is constant in all the cells? Well, let's consider what it would look like if lambda is not constant. What if lambda is really huge in five of the cells and very small in all the rest of them? Maybe in the first five it's 10 million, and then the rest it's one. Pardon? Go ahead. Yeah, the deviation would be very big. You'd see some of these numbers here would be, x bar would be kind of small if the sample size is large. X bar would be kind of small, but then you'd see some big numbers here, right? On the other hand, if lambda is constant throughout them, then all the xi's would be approximately the same. In fact, they'd be kind of close to the mean. So this should be small if this is small, we would suspect that lambda is constant. Okay? So what should the test be?
X squared is bigger than some.
Something, then we reject, right? Okay, so the test is if x squared is big, we reject. So to attain a certain significance level, so this means the probability under the null hypothesis. So these are chi squared under the null hypothesis. Okay, so the book provides a couple of examples of this. One is in counting asbestos fibers. So they're on some rectangular or square filter like this, and you punch out holes from this thing, and you count the number of asbestos fibers in each patch that you punch out. So in the example in the book, they took 23 punches from this filter. Oh, and I erased that. And from that, lambda hat equal x bar was 24.9. So the average number of asbestos fibers per patch is 24.9. The There's a little table in the book that gives all the 23 numbers. There's some like 31, 34, 26, blah, 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 28, 18, 22. And you put all those numbers in here. And if you do that, if you're patient enough to do that, this turns out to be 26.56. And minus 2 log lambda. Oops, this is not n up here, it's 23. Well, I said n is 23, but 23. So they're almost the same. I guess they're off by about a half. We find from the table or from a numerical computation that the probability that x squared is bigger than 26.56 is 0.21. Okay. So this is x squared here. How would you find that probability? What's the sampling distribution of x squared? Remember, it's chi squared. And how many degrees of freedom do we have here? 23. Is it 23 or 22? 22. N minus 1, 22. And so you can look this up in a table somewhere. Maybe not the table in our book, I'm not sure. There's a table somewhere. So what is this number? This is the data. This is what we observed. This is the probability that if you do this again, you'll observe something more extreme than what you saw. So this is called the p-value. This is the p-value. The p-value is 0.21. So what does it say? 79 times out of 100, you'll find a larger value of x squared than you found. This is the p-value of the data you found. 79 times out of 100, x squared will exceed 26.56. So that's a pretty big majority of the time, right? So what's your feeling then about the hypothesis that lambda is constant? Most of the time you find a more extreme value for your statistics, so you should feel comfortable in thinking that lambda is constant here. Yeah?
No, I'm going to ask if the probability of x squared being greater than 26 is 0.21, would that mean that 79 times out of 100 it would be less than 26.5?
That's what I thought. Oh, right. Yeah, I'm sorry. I got it the wrong way. Did I write it the wrong way? Let's see. Okay, so yes, just 21 times out of 100. Sorry, 21 times out of 100, you'll see something more extreme. So this sort of biases you against it being constant, sorry. This biases you, or it might make you think that lambda is not constant. Is this strong evidence that lambda is not constant? This is moderate evidence, I would say. Yeah. The evidence against lambda being constant is not strong, but some, I mean, sort of indicates that it might not be constant, but it's not real strong. If it were, if the p-value were what, like 0.05 or something, then you'd be happy to say that lambda is not constant. Okay, so it's not very satisfying, is it? But that's life. Okay, another example is about bacterial clumps. Here, milk is spread over a square slide, glass slide, which is 1 centimeter by 1 centimeter. And how much? 0.01 milliliter of milk is spread over 1 centimeter square slide. The slide is subsequently divided up into subsquares. How many subsquares? 400 subsquares. And the bacteria is counted. And bacteria is counted in each square. By observation under a microscope. Okay. And the data are recorded in the book. So you get a table of, well, you don't get a table of 400 numbers, actually. You get more of a frequency count. So you get the table looks like this. Observed number of cell, let's see, so for example, the number some of the cells have no bacteria at all. How many of those have no bacteria? 56 cells. Some of the cells have only one bacteria cell in them. How many are there like that? 104 cells. Some have two, et cetera. So that's what the information looks like. So from a table like that, you can compute the mean. If you knew how many cells had none, how many cells had one, how many cells had two, and you knew how many cells there were, how would you compute the X bar? You take 0 times 56 plus 1 times 109 plus 2 times this number, etc., and then divide by 400. Okay, and you could also compute all these things here, and what you get. Excuse me. Oh, thanks. X squared is 75.4, and this turns out to be Oh, if I sneeze into the microphone, it'll be louder. I don't know what happens. Okay. So, where is I here? If 6 degrees of freedom, one for each, let's see. The data is clumped into 0, 1, 2, 3, up to 5, I believe, or 6. Yeah. X bar is 2.44. That's our lambda hat. And chi squared for 6 degrees of freedom. The point where you get yeah.
Are you supposed to have two zeros there,
or
is it just one?
Is it 1, 0, 5? Yeah, I don't know. I'm wondering whether I made a misprint in what I wrote here. I probably wrote too many zeros. That's right, 0.005 is 18.55. So the probability that chi squared is bigger than this is 0.005. So what's the probability that you see 75.4 here? Very, very low. So what would you do? You would reject even at this very low significance level. So reject the null hypothesis. So it's very definitive against constant lambda throughout the cells. Now, the data are clumped into groups of cells. And there's sort of a compression of the degrees of freedom then to smaller number of degrees of freedom. But I think group it into cells where there are 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or more, I think. And so here you'd reject. And I guess they give some physical reasons why you might not see a constant lambda throughout. One is when you're applying the milk to the slide, you maybe are spreading it across, and there are some things related to surface tension that would make more bacteria stick right where the milk is applied to the cell, even though you spread it around. Some of it would stick more.
We want to say that the probability that one bacteria sticks to a cell is completely dependent from another bacteria sticking to it, right?
Right. There might be correlations, but also you're going to maybe you drop, put a drop on here, and then you spread it out. And then where the drop was first applied, you might see more bacteria, things like that. Okay, so let's see. Let's take a break now. I think that's test about Poisson constant parameter versus variable parameter. So here you'd have a variable parameter. Let's see, when were the last problems due? 33, 36, 39?
Correct.
Wednesday or today?
Wednesday.
Wednesday. Do you want to go through them now so that you can make sure you get them all right?
Okay.
39? Let's do 33, 36, and 39. Actually, there are a couple others that I think you should do as well from that section. So these have to do with the multinomial, finding the PI, P sub I. So you're so there's some parameterization of the P's. For example, the Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium, there are three cells corresponding to the genotypes capital A, capital A, capital A, small a, small a, small a, and the probabilities here were 1 minus theta squared for P1, 2 theta 1 minus theta for P2, and theta squared for P3. Theta does not have to be one parameter. Parameter, it could be multi-parameter. And then the we derive this minus 2 log lambda is twice sum I equal 1 to n logarithm of the observed minus the expected over the observed, I think. This is it's not a number yet. This is a review of the test for multinomial. Okay, so pi of theta hat is the p1 of or theta hat is the MLE for theta. Which you get from the data. And so O stands for observed. You observe xi particles, individuals, objects in the ith cell. N is the number of let's see. No, OI is XI, I think, sorry. So, yeah, OI is XI, sorry. And the X squared statistic No, over EI, sorry, EI. And these would be chi squared with n minus 1 minus the dimension of the space where theta runs. Degrees of freedom. Okay. This is what we did probably Monday or Wednesday last week. I forget which day. So we use these in problems 33, 36, and 39. 33, I guess you've probably all read it by now, suggested that dying people may be able to postpone their death until after an important occasion. Anybody know when Mark Twain died? Do you know when he was born?
He told us the day
yeah.
his yeah. came around and then when it came around again.
Yeah, so it seems like he delayed his death. But anyway, Mark Twain died on the he was born and died on consecutive appearances of Halley's Comet.
What's the probability that that was just a coincidence?
Well, I would say the probability that somebody was born and died on the appearance of Halley's Comet is quite high. So, yes, why not him? But I think he did say, I came in on it, and I'm going to go out on it or something. But anyway, it says that people might postpone death until after an important occasion. So this is studied. Studied the patterns of death surrounding Passover, an important Jewish holiday, during the years 66 to 84. They compared the number of deaths during the week before to the number after. 1,919 people who had Jewish surnames were observed, and or their deaths were recorded. They looked at 1,919 people who died with Jewish surnames. 922 died the week before, 997 the week after. So this is a problem with two cells, cell 1 and cell 2. Cell 1 being the week before, people dying the week before, and cell 2 being dying the week after. So it's to count as 922 versus 997. Is it 997?
997.
Yeah, okay. 997, yes. So X1 is 922. X2 is 997. What's the, what would the null hypothesis? Yeah.
The T did this problem.
Pardon?
The T did this problem.
Oh, so you don't need to see this.
She couldn't do number 39.
She couldn't do 39. Oh, okay, so we don't have to go through this.
Yeah.
Oh.
I think it would be helpful.
Oh, okay. Okay. So what's the null hypothesis here? What do you think?
They're
equally likely? Yeah. So the null hypothesis would be, sorry to bore you, but H0 would be P1 equal P2. And of course, that means they have to be a half. And I guess H1 is P1 is not P2. Or maybe maybe this could be refined. What would yeah. Now that you might think that's the null hypothesis. I don't know. It's up to you. What do you think? You don't always have to. Is it always clear what should the null hypothesis be? The null hypothesis might be what you think it is. Well, I mean, what you think is the real situation. Maybe you think this is the real situation. Or maybe you think you have to be convinced that this isn't true. The data should convince you somehow that this is true. Yeah.
But shouldn't we have to consider it as not equal to? Because what if it happens that gene one actually ends up being greater than...
Yeah, that could be. the stress of preparing for the holiday might knock people off.
Yeah.
Okay. So, what's our test look like? I think x squared is easy to compute here. X minus 2 log lambda is not too bad, but it involves computing logarithms. But I guess that's just a matter of, you have nice calculators, don't you? I mean, you can do that. But I think you can do this one without any calculator. So let's compute x squared. So what's O1 here? It's, yeah, O2, yeah, 997. E1, under the null hypothesis, we expect, say it again? Oh, yeah. Yeah, you add that up, it's 1919 over 2, which is 959.5 equal E2. So O1 minus E1 is that, I guess I have to square it.
37.5.
Yeah, and if you square 37.5, you get
1406.25.
And O2 minus E2?
Same.
Yes. Oh, I see. This is as much. Yeah, of course. It has to be. Why is that? There are only two numbers, so the two numbers are equally far from their average. The average is right in the middle. Right. Okay, and then we divide this one by E1 and the other one by E2. Is that right?
Yeah.
And what is this? 2812.5 over 959.5, which is about what? 3? Pardon? Say again?
2.9312.
Okay, and our x squared is chi squared with how many degrees of freedom? One. And so what's the p-value of this statistic? We have to look up table 2. I'm sorry. Table 3, I think. 2 is normal. Well, it looks like about 0.92. Wait. Chi squared bigger than... So it's about 0.08, I think. I think it's about approximately 0.08. Is that what you got? Just from looking at the... Probably the chi-squared with 1 degree of freedom is less than... I think in the table it has 2.7 something, maybe, is 0.9. So this one fell between the chi-squared of 0.9 and chi-squared of 0.92. 0.95. So I say it's about 0.9. The probability being less than that is about 0.92. So the probability being bigger is 0.08. So the p-value is 0.08. So what do you think? Accept or reject the null hypothesis? How many say accept null hypothesis? How many say reject null hypothesis? Okay, how firmly do you feel about this? Nobody did this? How come? This is a pretty low significance level, isn't it? There's a pretty small p-value. Let's see. What do you think? Accept or reject? Accept, probably. If you set the significance level at 0.1, what would you do? If you set the significance level at 0.1, would this number, this would have to be larger to get 0.1 here, right? And we saw this, so we would accept at, so it's not clear, it depends on, you're supposed to set this in advance, by the way, not after. If alpha is 0.005 and our test is accept at this significance level, what would we accept or reject here? We would reject. Wouldn't we? Because to get this probability to be 0.05, this would have to be bigger, right? 0.05 is smaller than this, so we have to go further out.
Don't you accept the null hypothesis because you're not agreeing with your prediction?
Wouldn't I accept it? Well, it depends on what I set.
Yeah, you see 0.08, and then your significance level is 5%.
Yeah, so this would be a, if this were true, then let's check it out. We'd have to find C of alpha such that the probability of chi squared with 1 degree of freedom is bigger than C of alpha is, maybe you're right, 0.05. Now what would this number be? In the text it's equal to it's 3 something I think, or is it 2.7? Which one is this? Is this 2? 3.84, right?
Yeah.
Okay, and what did we see? We saw that, so we would accept.
Yeah.
We would accept. At the significance level 0.05, we would accept the null hypothesis because the test would be if x squared is bigger than 3.84, we reject. Our x squared was less than 3.84, so we accept. What if the significance level was 0.1? If it's 0.1, what's the C alpha? It's 2.7 something, I believe, right? Darren, you should have kept the page open. Yeah. 0.1. If alpha is 0.1, C of alpha is 2.7 something?
2.71.
So the 0.1 significance level test rejects H naught if x squared is bigger than 2.71. What was our x squared? 2.9 something. So we reject at significance level 0.1, but we'd accept at significance level 0.05. So, you know, it depends on what significance level you set. The p-value is what? 0.08. So do if the p-value is really big, what does that tell you about the null hypothesis? If the p-value of your observation is really big. Pardon?
Your null hypothesis is true.
If the p-value is really small? Yeah. So what was the p-value that Mendel had? Yeah, which meant that almost any other time you perform that experiment, you'd see something more extreme than what he saw. Okay. Okay. So this says that most of the time, you'd see something a little bit less than this, right? When you perform this test under the null hypothesis. Okay, so it's not clearly true, it's not clearly false, I would say. Anybody disagree with that assessment? Okay, all right. Any other question about 33 then? And you could do this as well with the log is with the, this one, remember, this is called the Pearson chi-squared. Okay, let's go to 36. Or should we do 39 to make sure we get, we'll do 39 first, and the first time we'll do 36. Okay, so this is about folklore of the effects. When my, I don't know if I told you this, when my youngest son was about 6 or 7, I told him how much a bite of a vampire hurts. I told him, don't worry, I won't. There's a great deal of folklore about the effects of full moon on humans and other animals. Do animals bite more during full moon? And probably yes, because they can see you better. I don't know. Okay. So they collected data on admissions to medical facility for treatment of bites by animals, cats, such as cats, rats, horses, dogs. 95% of the bites were by man's best friend, the dog. So ironic, I guess, yeah. A bit of irony there. The lunar cycle is divided into 10 periods. So that's 10 cells, right? So there would be how many degrees of freedom? 9. Okay. Is there a temporal trend in the incidence of bites? Okay. All right. So we form this thing here with I equal 1 to 10. Right? And what's the null hypothesis here? Yeah, that they're equally likely, I would say. Why would you choose that as a null hypothesis?
Because it's more simple than not.
Yeah, it's simpler. Also, you can, you know what the distribution will be under the null hypothesis. You have to compute that to get the chi-squared statistics. So the null hypothesis would be, let's say, if PI is a probability of being bitten on the ith period, PI would be 1 over 10. Okay. Okay, now this involves a bit more computation than the other ones. In the end, we'll get a chi-squared with 9 degrees of freedom. The observed values are 150, 1 what? 01 is 137, 02 is 150. And now I just now realized we didn't finish problem 33, did we? There was another set of data, but it's the same, treated the same way. Okay. Oh, 05 is 269. Oh, 06 is 155. 07 is 142. 08 is 146. 09 is 148. 010 is 110. And all the EIs are equal to what? Yeah, 1/10 of the total number. We have to add up all these. Did it say what the sum is? How many? Okay, the sum of these is 1621. So EI would be 1/10 of that, 162.1. Okay. So, OI minus EI. This is fun. Let's see, this looks to me, I'm only going to worry about the absolute value. Because why? We're going to square it. So, is this 25.1? And this would be 12.1, and this would be 0.9, and then 38, 30, is this 39.1 for 4? I'm sorry, 29.1? No, 39, yeah. No, 38.9. Six point nine, 7.1, 20.1, 16.1, 48, 14.1, and 52.1. Is that right? And now we have to square those.
I have the first five.
Maybe we could do what they did in the Manhattan Project, split this up. So Stacy, you said you've done the first five?
Yes.
You've squared the first five?
Yes.
Okay, then I forgot your name. Your job is to square the second five. Oh,
I do. I have a total system.
Wow, okay. All right, we'll just.
Here, just read these off and I'll do the rest.
Okay, read them off. Yeah, yeah. Okay, and then it's who's going to do the job of dividing by EI? How about you? Okay. And you read them off. Tell me the squares.
41.
Got it.
0.81.
Yeah.
15.13.2. 11,427.61. 50.41.
50.41. Okay.
404.01.
0.81?
And 2714.41.
Point what? 41. Thank you. Okay. And you do the first five, divide by EI, and you do the second five, divide by EI. And then you add them up.
No.
Okay, Darren, you can read them off. I didn't hear the first part. 9.335.
70.45. Melanie Davidson.
I've done the first three. 0.3109 for 50.41.
Okay.
2.492 for the 404.
Okay.
1.599.
That one is 1.226.
And 6 to 1.75.
Okay. All right. Who's going to add them up?
93.3.
So the sum is 93.3?
Yeah. And the back is 85.
In the back of the book, they get 85?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, yes? No, I guess not. But you could have told me it was in the back of the book. Okay, so that's not the... I guess the issue here isn't can we add up all these numbers. Probably the book is correct.
Last cycle, because it's only 2 days, it's not 1/10 of it. Oh, yeah. That's why your numbers is different.
Oh, I see.
Because the first 9 cycles are 3 days each, and the 10th one's only 2 days.
I see. Yeah. So... oh gosh, so it has less, well, let's assume it's 3 days. okay, that would give you different, all right, so yeah, so there are 10 cycles, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. I didn't notice that, sorry. And number of days? 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, 3. Was it 2?
Yeah.
Okay. So that adds up to how many days? That's 29. So the probability here would be 3/29, 3/29, 2/29. All right? So the null hypothesis would be not 1/10, but I like 1/10 better. Let's assume it's 1/10. I'm not going to go through the computation, but probably the reason we got 93.3 isn't we made a mistake, though that could happen. That's the null hypothesis, or that's the alternative hypothesis. Probably the reason we didn't get 85.5 is we didn't use these p's, and that would change the e's, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so but let's stick with this. Well, what do you think? Let's, okay, you forget that you saw the data. give me a significance level. Anybody? 0.1? 0.05? 0.05. Okay, so let's say we take alpha equal 0.05. Do we accept or reject when we observe this data? Our test is in what? Our chi-square is chi-square how many degrees of freedom?
9
degrees of freedom. So we want to find chi squared 9. Our test level is chi squared 9 of .95, right? We want to find this in the table. And is it on the table?
92.
Okay. So what's our test? What do we do if we see data bigger than that? If, yeah, x squared is bigger than 16.92, reject. So what do we do? Do we reject?
Yes.
Okay. In fact, what's the p-value of our data? What's the probability that a chi squared with this many degrees of freedom is bigger than 93.3? It must be almost zero. Almost never happens, right? So we'd reject the null hypothesis that the probabilities are equal. So there is some variability in when the dog bites. Is that in that song? When the dog bites? These are a few of my favorite things. These are a few of my. Or is it when the bee stings? So, well, when do they bite more often, these animals, these beasts? Day 29 is a full moon. Uh-oh. Looks like it might be right, according to these data. Isn't it? Look like it, maybe they bite more often on a full moon. Who knows why? I don't know. So I would say reject the null hypothesis that they that's the same probability from month to month. I think it's pretty clear. Okay, well, we did a problem like number 40. I didn't assign 40, but 40 is a good one to do, as is 41. I also like 43. Number 40 says, consider testing goodness of fit for a multinomial with 2 cells. The first problem was a multinomial with 2 cells, right? The week before Passover, week after. Oh, do you want to do it? We can. I think it's almost the same as these. This is just a different narrative, but same, yeah. You compute observed minus expected squared over expected. So the null hypothesis would be that suicide rates are the same from month to month. So pi would be 1/12, I guess, I equal 1 through 12. And then the expected would be the total number of suicides times the 12th. That's what EI would be all the time. And then the OI you read off from the data. And you form this, you could do either the Pearson chi-squared, which is the sum of these guys, or you could do the minus 2 log lambda, which I've erased, sum of the, okay? So it's same in form. In number 40, it says, consider a multinomial with 2 cells. X1 and X2 are the hypothesized, are the observations in each cell, and let P1, P2 be the hypothesized probabilities. So there's some hypothesis. Maybe this, the hypothesis is that P1 is a fourth, P2 is 3/4, something like that. Okay? And what would Pearson's chi-squared look like? That. But now, which would be that. But there's some relation between x1, x2, and n, and p1 and p2. What's the relation? N is the number of observations. X is the number observed in cell 1. X1 is the number observed in cell 1. X2 is the number observed in cell 2. So X1 plus X2 must equal, yes. And P1 plus P2 must be, so we can eliminate X2 and P2 from here. Just have everything in terms of X1 and P1. P2 is 1 minus P1, and X2 is N minus X1. And let's simplify this if we can. Let's see. There's an N. There's a minus N. So they cancel. That and that will cancel. There's a minus x1 and there's a plus p1. Minus x1 plus p1. Right. I'm sorry, plus np1. But that's the same if I'm squaring it, it's the same as this. Right? So we have the same term in both numerators. And all we have to do now is combine the denominators. And I believe it becomes this, because 1 over P1 plus 1 over 1 minus P1 is, let's see, common denominator is P1 times 1 minus P1. And here we'd have 1 minus P1, because I multiply by that. And here I have P1, because I multiply by that. And 1 minus P1 plus P1 is 1. OK, so that's what Pearson's chi-squared comes out to be. And that's x1 minus np1 over square root of np1, 1 minus p1. Quantity squared, and what's the distribution of x1? If you have multinomial and you look at just the number in one cell, that's binomial. X1 has a binomial distribution with parameter n and p1. Binomial with parameter n and p1 is the sum of n Bernoullis with parameter p1. So I have here the sum of n identically distributed random variables, Bernoullis with parameter P1. What's this? That's the expected value of that sum, and this is the variance, squared of the variance of that sum. So I've subtracted the mean divided by the square root of the variance. What distribution would this thing inside here be close to? Normal with mean 0 and variance 1, and I square it, so it's close to a chi-square, which is what we knew from, that's the theorem that we never proved about the minus 2 log lambda. This is close to the minus 2 log lambda. And so what does 40 say? Well, that was the point of 40, I guess. All right, so let's look at 43. In 1965, this is before computer games. A high school student reported getting 9,207 heads and 8,743 tails when he tossed a coin. So why did I mention this was before computer games? How much time do you think it would take to toss that many coins? I think kids are too busy nowadays to toss a coin that often. Is this a significant discrepancy from the null hypothesis that P is a half? So this is like a two-cell problem, I guess, right? So x1 would be the number of heads. N would be what? The total number of coin tosses. So this is number 43. What is N in this case? Okay, 17,950. X1 was the number of heads, is what? What did he say it was? 9,207. So the null hypothesis would be that P1 equal P2 equal to a half. So what is this number here? With these data, it would be 9,207 minus half of the half of n would be, what is that? Is it 8975, and then divided by, let's see, P1 times 1 minus P1 is a fourth. A fourth of that is what? 17950 divided by 4. 4161. Say it again.
4487.5.
So square root of 4487.5. And numerator I can do, I think. That'd be 232. 25 to get up to 9,000. 25 plus 27 is 232. And what's the square root of this?
66.99.
Well, actually, yeah, okay, so now we just do 232 squared over 4,487.5. 232 squared over this number is what?
11.99.
Okay. Now, what's the p-value then? the probability that our x squared, our statistic, is bigger than n.
Bless you.
This is chi squared with 1 degree of freedom. Table 3. I'm sorry, you found it? Oh, it's way off the charts, right? So, probably chi squared with 1 degree of freedom is bigger than 7. Probably x squared is bigger than, is it 7.88? Is it 0.995 or? So this is really almost 1. Almost 1, right? Oh, 1 minus that, yeah, 1 minus 1. It's almost 0. P-value is extremely small. So what does that mean? We reject. We don't see statistics this extreme very often under the null hypothesis. So do you think the coins were fair?
Nope.
Or that the experiment was there's a flaw somehow, yeah. Okay. So I guess that's it. See you Wednesday. Thank you.